above every name, the name that is so worthy of our praise. And it is in your name that we find peace. It's in your name that we find forgiveness. It's in your name we find healing. So we are going to call on that name today. You show me every breath I breathe is from you. Every fingerprint part of you. I am yours from start to end. You hold me, and even when I wander, you are never farther than just a word away. Oh, I call your name when I say,
reaching down out of the heavens, all to sculpt the heart of man. Not in gold and not in silver, nothing precious or is forever. Come on, sing glory.
Father, we just lift you up, God, from our hearts, from our minds, our thoughts, our words, our actions, God, that they would be found in who you are. And God, as we've sang songs this morning and we've worshiped you in spirit and in truth, I pray as we continue in our act of worship of a message from your word, Lord, your holy word, the scriptures that are living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, God, I pray that you would go forward in this word, that you would challenge us to live the life you've called us to live, to be a light into our community, and to equip us to be all that you've called us to be as your sons and daughters. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen. Well, I am so excited for this week. Welcome to Clearview Church online service, and I just want to tell you that we love you and we are praying for you, and it is an incredible week as we kick off our Driven by Eternity series. And this series will lead us all the way up into Easter, which is going to be so much fun that weekend. We've got a Good Friday service coming. We've got two Sunday services, and it is going to be awesome as we celebrate our risen Savior and the reason why we do what we do on a daily basis. And I'm so excited for this series as we're driven by eternity, because as we learn and dive into the Word of God and how we're to operate, when we do things in light of eternity, it shifts the way that we think, the way that we act, and the way that we speak, so that we can help build the kingdom of God here on earth with that simple prayer that Jesus taught his disciples: on earth as it is in heaven. God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so we are excited this week. We're excited for the weeks to come as we learn more about what it means to be driven by eternity. If you have your Bibles at home and you're looking up, we're going to be in Colossians chapter 3, 1 through 17. And we'll get there in a minute, but I want to break this down for you. Okay. Driven is to relentlessly be compelled by the need to accomplish a goal, or somebody who's very hardworking. That's driven. The word by indicates the means of achieving something. So when we are driven, we're often driven by something. So we have we are relentlessly compelled by the need to accomplish something. And the by indicates the means of achieving. So what are we driven by? And in our lives, we can be driven by a lot of different things. And those things that fits the by, what comes right after it determines our actions, our thoughts, our emotions, our response, if we respond or if we react, right? And so what are we driven by? I want to challenge you to think through those things, but I also want to encourage you and equip you to be driven by eternity. Eternity is endless life after death. There's a stark reality for every person who lives on the earth. You are a soul, you have a body. That body will one day lay to rest here on the earth, whether it's through cremation or being buried. But the reality is your soul has an eternal purpose, and in that is community with God, and that is found through a relationship with Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. We're gonna see some of that in Colossians chapter 3. But the other option is not embracing Jesus as your Lord and Savior in this life here today. Not saying, I believe that Jesus Christ is holy God and holy man, that he died on a cross for my sin, and through this process I can be forgiven of my sins and enter into an eternal relationship with God. You see, your soul has an eternal purpose, and it's either going to go to community with God for the rest of its eternity, or it is going to spend life apart from God in hell. Heaven, hell. Real places, real eternities. Here's the thing. When we look at this and we're driven by eternity, it's going to shift the way that we think, the way that we act, and the way that we speak. And today I hope that it equips you for the way that God lays out the Christian life and being with Christ, hidden in God, and the plan that he has over your life. And when we put driven by eternity together, I want you to see this. It's to be relentlessly compelled by the need to achieve everlasting life after death. Everlasting life after death. Everlasting life is found in the presence of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You see, at the beginning, before anything was ever formed or spoken into creation, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit existed, the Trinity. We believe that God is Father, God is Son, that we know is Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. And the Trinity existed prior to creation, and at creation breathed life and formed the world. God created a place and a people for his presence to dwell. The presence of God exists prior to creation, and in him, through him, all things were created. And so when we look at that, the only thing that can be eternal is God and the plan that he has for you and I. And that leads us to that driven by eternity. May we be relentlessly compelled by the need to achieve everlasting life after death. And that need to achieve is us honoring God, right? Everlasting life after death is found in Christ by faith alone. You cannot earn it, okay? There's nothing you can do to pay your way into heaven. Christ already paid the price for it. But let our actions, our thoughts, and our words be driven or motivated by getting to heaven. And what do I mean by that? Our purpose here on earth in Christ Jesus, empowered by the Holy Spirit, is to be God's witnesses to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And God's plan over you and I is to develop that within us. And as he develops that within us, our goal isn't simply to arrive at the pearly gates and hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. But the well done, my good and faithful servant needs to be accompanied by the fact that you are here on the earth and you were obedient to Scripture, that you honored God, and that you brought as many people into relationship with God as possible. And I know that sounds crazy because, look, we're not all going to be Billy Graham, okay? We're not all going to be able to articulate the gospel as well as some of the greatest speakers in the world that the world has ever seen in its existence. However, God has placed you around people who need to know that his son Jesus loves him and cares for them. God has placed you in the path of people that with the simplicity of a kind word can change their eternity. Because in that moment, you shift their capacity to understand who God is because you are loving them in a way they've never experienced it. It doesn't have to be complicated. You don't have to have a complex story. You just need to know that God is good, he is faithful, and he has called you to be his witness where you're at, throughout the state, across the nation, and around the world. Before we get into Colossians 3, let us pray. Heavenly Father, I pray over this word today, God, that it would motivate, encourage, inspire, and equip us to be driven by eternity. God, that it would shift our perspective from the temporary gains that we could have to eternal contributions that we desire. And God, I pray that you birth a fire in each of us to passionately and boldly pursue your throne room, Lord, so that we can be more effective in sharing the gospel than ever before, that there would be a boldness and strength over the body of believers that call Clearview Church home and over the Big C Church across the world, God, that you would give us strength and boldness and opportunities to be your hands and feet, to love compassionately, to be the church. God, I thank you and I love you and I give you all praise and all glory and all honor. And I pray that you'd have your way in the rest of this service. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to read right through Colossians 3, 1 through 17, and then we're going to break it down. So here we go. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on the things above, not only on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways, and in this life you once lived. But now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices, and have been put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, in verse 12, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And all of these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Verse 15. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through the psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. You see, Colossians is a letter that Paul writes from jail to the church in Colossae to address a mixed bag of theology. One of the things that's going on in chapter 3, I believe, is chapter 3 of 4 chapters in the book of Colossians. And it's, again, it's a letter written to the church in Colossae. And that letter that's written, Paul's writing it from prison, and it's to address a mixed bag of theology, because you've got Jews, you've got Gentiles, and you've got different people coming together and kind of adding their own spin to what was established and taught when the church was established. And one of the things that he's dealing with is helping them have the perspective of what it meant and what it means to have life in Christ. And life in Christ leads to eternal life. And these are the things that we need to do in order to continue on that path and help others onto that path. So as we look at these things, this is what we see. Point number one. Our minds determine our well-being. Our minds determine our well-being. Romans 12, 1 through 2 says this. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, God withholding the punishment due to us, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. God's mercy withholds the punishment of death because we are in Christ. All right, it says, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. So offer everything that you are, your words, your actions, your thoughts, your mind, your body, your soul, everything that you are, offer it to God as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to Him. This is your true and proper worship. You can't separate it from the other things that you do in your life. You need to recognize that true and proper worship is that you are honoring God with your mind, with what you look at, with what you hear, with what you speak, with what you search, with what you talk about, with other people, with the things that you do, where you go, all of those things. Everything you do adds up to the true and proper worship, offering yourself as a living sacrifice. Allowing God to use you, putting yourself in that place of saying, God, here I am, use me, and being okay with what He asked you to do and the outcome, filtering it through Scripture. Colossians 3, 1 through 2 says this, and remember, our minds determine our well-being. Verse 2 of Romans 12, 1 and 2. Do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. God's will is good, pleasing, and perfect. How do we learn what God's will is and be able to approve and test of it? It says, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. When you came into relationship with Christ, a transformation of your heart takes place. But before you received that, you cognitively put together and said, I believe. Belief is the action of faith. Faith is being sure of what you hope for and certain of what you cannot see. And so in your mind, you cognitively said, I believe that God, that Jesus died on a cross for my sins and that God raised Him from the dead. And in that moment, your mind is renewed, your heart is transformed. Baptism, what we do with water, is an outward declaration of the inward transformation that takes place in our hearts and in our minds when we come into relationship with Jesus Christ. It's to let the church know that this is who I am. I am new in Christ. As we look at that in Romans 12, 2, do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world. And we're going to see this through, we just read it in Colossians 1 through 17. We're going to see it through the rest of the message. Is that no longer should we operate the way we did before Christ. Rather, because Christ is with us and we are hidden in God, we should be operating in a new manner. Our words, our actions, and our thoughts should shift and change. We shouldn't excuse it by saying, I'm just a real person. This is who I am. So I speak the way I speak. I think the way I think. I act the way I act. The reality is if Christ is in you, that's going to change. If you are surrendered to Christ, if you have given yourself up for the cause of the kingdom and said, I believe that this is my purpose in life, is to lead people to Jesus. Whether you're a business person, you work in the healthcare field, you're in ministry, you're a teacher, you're a parent, you're a child, you're a student, whatever role you have in life, that is your role, not your overall purpose. Your overall purpose is found in Christ and is to operate through those roles in your life. But the way we start is our minds determine our well-being. Our mind is the data center of everything that we think, say, act, and do. It's what filters everything that comes to our heart, and then we, above all else, guard our heart because it affects everything we do. It goes from our mind to our heart, from our heart to our hands and our feet. And if we want to be the hands and feet of Jesus, we've got to guard our heart, but we need to filter everything that we experience, that we process, that we see, that we hear, that we think, that we speak, the conversations we have, the interactions we have, the experiences we have, need to filter through and be filtered by Scripture and our biblical worldview so that we can operate the way that God has called us to and be driven by eternity. Our minds determine our well-being. There are countless people in the church and outside the church not just Clearview Church, but the church, that are struggling in the battlefield of the mind. It is where the enemy chooses the strongest fight he has, because if he can win in your mind, he can defeat you for a season or a time. But God renews your mind. Don't conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but by the renewing of your mind, be transformed. Number two, driven by eternity. So the first one, our minds determine our well-being. Driven by eternity. Number two is going to be Colossians 3, 3 through 4. We are hidden with Christ in God. We come into relationship with Christ, our Savior, when we choose to profess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our hearts that God raised Him from the dead. We are saved. And our relationship with Him starts, and we come together with Christ. We're now empowered by the Holy Spirit, and we are hidden in God. I think this scripture is very critical as we think about what did sin do in the garden. It exposed Adam and Eve that they were naked, and what did they do from God? They hid from God. But what did God do when He sent Jesus, His Son, to die on a cross? Is He gave us the ability to be in relationship with Him constantly, to be able to ask for forgiveness in our moments of weakness, and be able to look and pursue an eternal life and receive eternal life. And in that moment, we aren't hiding from God, but we are found with Christ, hidden in God. How incredible is that? Verse 3, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, I want you to see that. It's not when Christ, who is a part of your life. It is not when Christ, who is starting your life. No. It says, when Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. Your relationship with Christ as your Savior and making Him your personal Lord and Savior. You can't ride the coattails of your parents' faith. You can't ride the coattails of your friends' faith. It needs to be a personal decision that you make that says, I believe that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. And here's what it means. It means that you realize and recognize that as a person, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but God loves you so much where you're at. He doesn't judge you where you're at, but He says, let me tell you, there's so much better ways for you to live than the way you're currently living apart from me, and I want to see you have a fruitful life. So why don't you come and get connected to the vine so that you can bear much fruit? Because apart from me, you can do nothing. And I know you don't understand what that means right now, but I have a relationship with you through Christ. I gave up my Son because I love you so much for where you're at, and I love you so much. I don't want to just leave you where you're at, but I want you to experience the splendor of living in God's principles while here on the earth, experiencing some of eternity while we live in this temporary place. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, so when you embrace Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are dying to yourself. You are giving up the way that you've operated and pursuing the way that God has called you to operate and created you to operate here on the earth. Number three, we put to death our earthly nature. That sounds harsh, but it's true. We put to death our earthly nature. If we are not willing to put it to death, then we're going to carry it around. What we wind up doing is we come to the altar, we put it down, and when we get up from the altar, we can weep, we can shake, we can pray, we can do everything we want to do. But here's the thing. If we choose not to leave it at the foot of the cross and we pick it back up and put it on our shoulder, we're going to carry it home with us. We put to death our earthly nature. Colossians 3, 5 through 7 says this, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. So what do we see? We see, one, we are hidden in Christ or with Christ in God. Not from God, but in Christ with God. Because of what God did by sending his son Jesus to die on the cross for you and I. So after that moment, it's our responsibility that when these things pop up, the things we need to put to death, our earthly natures, anything that basically leads to idolatry, sexual morality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry, we must put these to death. Why? Because this is why the wrath of God is coming. When God returns in glory, okay, when God returns in glory, that's it. We have one life to live here on the earth. And if he doesn't come back in our lifetime, I'm okay with that. If he does, I look up to the heavens and I say, come, Lord Jesus, come. Because it'll be a glorious day. Why? Because I know where I will be when the Lord returns. Do you? And we have to put it to death. We can't just sweep it under the rug. The Bible tells us, put to death our earthly nature. It's kind of like this. How many of you like spiders? I know some of you do, so don't judge me for this illustration, but let's be honest. If we are walking through our house and you take a spider out, or how many of you have ever just kind of opened the door and walked out the sliding door and just caught a spider web in the face, right? And I want you to think of that moment and what it felt like, and you're just like, oh, I've got to get it. And then you go back, and what do? You knock down the spider web. And what do we often do whenever we see a spider web? We knock it down. But what happens a day later? That spider web is right back there. We can't just keep knocking down the spider web. We can't knock down the symptoms of our sin. What we need to do is we need to kill the spider. The only way to guarantee not having that spider web come back, and now don't get me wrong, I understand that certain spiders and certain spider webs are good for different things, gardening and there's a lot, and bugs and all kinds of things that we can benefit from spiders. But if you are one that's not loving of spiders, then you're with me on this. And if you are one that loves spiders, just bear with me on this. But the reality is what we do with our sin is often the same thing we do with spiders. All we do, we think we're handling it. We think we're taking care of the root part of our sin, but what we actually are doing are we're just knocking down the cobwebs, right? We're just knocking down the spider webs so that way we don't walk through them, and the spider webs keep coming back, and it takes more work each time. The longer that we allow the spider to live and the more often we allow it to continue to spin its webs, okay, the more time we're going to spend. Each web it spins, it costs us more time in knocking down the spider web. But if we find the spider and we kill the spider, guess what we don't have anymore? The spider web. So we need to identify what are the things in our lives, what are the earthly nature things in our lives that are truly taking root, that are holding us back by living a life full of eternity in Christ, that Christ is our life. And what are the simple areas in our life? Search my heart, O God. We've been talking about this. It's been something God's been driving in me, and I feel like we all need to hear is that Psalm 139 prayer. Search my heart, examine my ways, know my anxious thoughts, remove anything that doesn't belong, and lead me in ways everlasting. And that'll probably be a sermon here in the next couple of weeks. But I just felt like in this week as we introduce this series that we need to recognize the strength of what God wants to do in and through each of us. And part of that is the harshness that we need to put to death our earthly nature. We need to kill the spiders in our lives so that the spider webs stop clogging up what God wants to do in and through us. Number four. We clothe ourselves in heavenly virtues. So I want us to see the pattern real quick. Our minds determine our well-being. We are hidden with Christ in God through relationship with Christ. He is our life. We put to death our earthly nature and we clothe ourselves with heavenly virtues. So you see, when we put to death our earthly nature, we are putting to death. We're not just sweeping it under the rug or killing the spider web. We're killing the spider, and we are not allowing it to take any more root or any more of our time or letting us walk into that spider web anymore. It's done. And then we need to clothe ourselves with heavenly virtue. We need to put on heavenly virtue. We need to clothe ourselves. It needs to be something that as we operate, when you walk into a room, things should change. The atmosphere should shift. The church, the body of believers should be the most hope-filled, life-giving people. Why? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. If I have life in Christ, then I should be the most life-giving person in the room. And when I gather with a body of believers, even when I'm having a struggle in my life, I can be full of joy because the joy of the Lord is my strength. And it fills me up. So what does it say that we clothe ourselves with heavenly virtues? Colossians 3, 12 through 14. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. So I want us to see this real quick. As we clothe ourselves with heavenly virtues, those virtues are compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And then we need to make sure that we put them all on with love, because that is what binds them all together in unity. And the strongest force on the face of the earth is unity. Because unity begets loyalty, loyalty begets strength. When we are unified together as a body of believers, pursuing the Word of God active in our life, we're going to change and transform the world around us. And then the people around us are going to start looking different. Why? Because I don't know too many people in the world who handle the compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, and love the way that Christ does. But I know as a body of believers, as one who are being sanctified to Christ and justified and atoned for our sins in Him and in His presence by the blood of Jesus, that you and I have an opportunity to shift the way that this world works, the way that it operates, the way that people see it. If we want to see a change, we need to be the change we want to see. I'm not saying get political. I'm saying we need to love people. We need to put to death our earthly nature. It's that personal revival. Lord, fill us up from our Vision Sunday. Lord, fill us up. That personal revival. Put to death our earthly nature. Repent for the things that we think, say, or do that don't please God. God, take these things from me. I don't even want to have a taste for them. But God, let me taste and see that the Lord is good. Then we clothe ourselves with the heavenly virtues, which makes it evident to all whose we are and allows people to see who we are. Compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, bound together in the unity of love, gives us the ability to be who God's called us to be, to live a life in Christ, with Christ, in God. As we continue on, we see in point number 5, then we let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. We let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. And then at the end of this, it ties it all together in verse 17. It talks about everything we do, do it for the Lord. Everything we do. So Colossians 3, 15 through 17. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you. So let the message of Christ be present among you. Let it rest in your hearts, in your words, in your language, in your actions. Richly, as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs of the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. Verse 17, and whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Let your words, your actions that start with your mind, be everything that God's called you to be. Everything God's called you to do. As we look at this today and we come to a close, I want us to see this. To be driven by eternity is to be relentlessly compelled by the need to achieve everlasting life. Our minds determine our well-being. We are hidden with Christ in God. That's part of His grand design for redeeming humanity. We put to death our earthly nature. We clothe ourselves with heavenly virtues. And then we let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. And as we let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts, We give room for God to do what only He can do in our lives. And then here's what's awesome. When the peace of Christ rules in our hearts, our external circumstances don't determine our joy. It doesn't determine our mindset. It doesn't determine the way that we think, the way that we act, that we speak. But rather, in that verse 17, and that's the critical one at the end of this, when peace rules in our hearts, it's easy for us to do everything that we do in the name of the Lord Jesus. It says, and whatever you do, whether in word or deed start as thoughts, right? So whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. So everything that you do, every role that you have on the face of the earth is not to be separate from the purpose that God has for you, but rather the purpose that God has for you should operate in you and through every role that you have. Let us all be driven by eternity, by an eternal relationship with our Heavenly Father, that one day, while our body may be laid to rest here on earth, our soul will be called to heaven, to be in the presence of Almighty God. How incredible a thought that is. How much we have to look forward to. But all the more so, while we're still here on the earth, all the more we have to pray and pursue and do on behalf of a good and gracious Heavenly Father who has done it all for us, now wants to do it through us so that more people can experience eternal life than ever before. Let me pray over you as we close out today. Heavenly Father, I pray over your people today. God, that you would do miraculous things in their lives. God, that you would see them exactly where they're at in their needs. And God, I pray that you would move in a mighty way. And as they continue on with the rest of their day and the rest of their week, that they would create environments to be in your presence as you created a place and a people for your presence to dwell. God, I pray that we would pursue you, pursue your presence, and allow you to move in our lives in such a unique way. Speak to us, empower us, equip us, and encourage us to be your church, to be the body of believers driven by eternity to make a kingdom impact in the lives of those who don't know your Son Jesus yet. We love you, we honor you, and we give you all praise and all glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Waking up to another light. No more sorrow and no more night. You're the light, let it shine.